Good afternoon, good morning, and a very warm welcome to today's session on how the reinsurance and insurance industry can power the renewable energy transition. My name is Anthony Kennaway, and I'm the head of public affairs here at Swiss Re. Now, according to the IEA, the world is set to add as much renewable power in the next 5 years as it did in the last 20. And the renewable reinsurance industry has a vital role to play in supporting that transition and in keeping renewable technologies on that path to maturity. Across the value chain of renewable energy, there's a complicated risk landscape, though, and we have to navigate that, and that's where our industry comes in. Now, I'm delighted to be joined in this conversation by three people who will help us work our way through it. First of all, by Michele Cibrario, who's the co-lead of our Centre of Competence on Renewable Energy. Second, by Mahesh Puttaiah, who's online with us and a senior economist from our Group Economic and Sigma research team. And last but not least, Dr. Christian Schaffner, who is the executive director of the Energy Science Center at Zurich's ETH. Christian, a very warm welcome to you. If I could start with you, and let's start with a sort of the macro context. Tell us a bit about the global race to net zero and the role of the renewable energy within that.
Yes, thanks a lot for having me here, of course. I mean, the first thing when you look at the facts, the numbers, is that at the moment, we don't have a race to net zero. At the moment, if you look at the fundamental values like the CO2 emissions or the CO2 concentration in the atmosphere, it's still rising. If you look at the numbers of fossil fuels being burned at the moment, it's still on the rise. So actually, when you look at these basic numbers, we are not at the race yet, and we have to go to the race, right? On the other hand, of course, when you look at what's being done, what's being invested, you just mentioned it, it's amazing what's happening, and the whole industries are changing now. And I think this is then the positive part. But we also have to look at these facts. So if you think about net zero by 2050, be it 45 or 55, it doesn't really matter, but just like getting somewhere then to net zero, it's a great, a big, big challenge. And it really means that basically we have to get rid of almost all fossil sources. There might be a little bit remaining. We might have a bit of CCS, but basically have to get to zero there. And that's a drastic change. We also need maybe technologies like negative emission technologies to get to actually zero at that. But still, the overall challenge is huge.
Okay. And then you just mentioned technologies there. Tell us a little bit about the technology. I mean, we know the technologies that we have, but tell us a little bit about those that are in the pipeline. Where are we going to see innovation? And what are the things that we should be a bit more excited about?
Yeah. I mean, if you look at the short and midterm, basically the main technologies are known. I mean, we know how to electrify mobility. We know how to electrify heating sector. So these are things that we just have to do, right? We basically know how to do it. We have to do it. We also know how to produce renewables. We know how to do wind. We know how to do PV. Also there, we just need to do it. Now, the really challenge comes in bringing all this together. If you have all these electric vehicles in the grid, in the system, that causes a challenge, or it can be part of the solution by doing, for example, vehicle to grid, where you use the battery as a storage capacity in the grid. And there are other things as well. If you have all these PV and wind, which is variable, you need storage. You need short-term storage, you need mid-term storage, long-term storage. All these technologies have to come in. So it's really all these supporting technologies. And then, of course, we have some technologies which we don't know yet how they will work. For example, if you go to seasonal storage, will this be done through chemical energy carriers? Can we use heat storage to store seasonally energy? So there are a lot of open questions. And of course, a big question being discussed a lot is hydrogen. So what is the role of hydrogen there? We see hydrogen as an important part, but it's probably also not the only part. So yes, there are quite a lot of these things. And also when we briefly discussed it before, when you look at the adaptation, the climate change that is coming to the energy sector, we will see huge challenges there as well. We will have more weather extremes, droughts, heat waves, which again influence the energy sector. So also there, we need to understand this. We need to be able to cope with this.
Right, okay. And weather extremes, of course, very topical at the moment in Europe. Thank you very much, Christian. So Mahesh, if we could come to you, please. So, you know, it's a formidable challenge ahead, it sounds like. Tell us a little bit about the renewable energy markets today.
Sure, Anthony, and thank you for having me here. As Dr. Christian said, there are challenging, but then in terms of the renewable energy installations, it's been quite encouraging. So there has been a strong growth over the years. If you look at the last decade alone, right, the total global installation more than doubled from about, say, 1.4 terawatt in 2012 to 3.4 terawatt in 2022. Which is a compound annual growth of around 9%, which is quite strong. And then growth is even stronger if you look at the modern renewables, particularly solar, right, which has increased 10 times during this period. So as a result of the strong growth, renewables now account for around 30% of global electricity generation compared to around what we had around 20% 10 years ago. And if you look at the modern renewables, mainly wind and solar, they now account for around 12% of global electricity generation compared to just about 3% a decade ago. This growth is driven by a couple of factors, the important one being the strong commitment by governments to reduce carbon emissions. And of course, the supportive policies because of these, and most importantly, the advancement in technology because of which the cost of installation has declined significantly over the years. And to give you some data around the commitment by government, right, more than 70, as of now, then there are more than 70 countries which account for close to 80% of global carbon emission and about 90% of global GDP. They have put some kind of net zero commitments in place. This is quite encouraging. And in addition, right, the recent energy crisis in the backdrop of Russia and Ukraine conflict, this has increased the pace of renewable energy installations last year. As a result, we saw a record addition of renewable energy capacity in 2022 alone. So looking ahead, and this trend is going to continue, right? And then looking ahead, growth would be even stronger over the next 5 years, right? According to the IEA forecast, between 2022 and 2027, renewables will grow by almost 2.4 terawatts will be the next net addition, which is more than what was added over the entire last decade. And then to just put some perspective to it, this capacity is equivalent to the total capacity of China as of today, right? And in terms of the technology, where it will expand, close to half of this additional capacity will be in solar and followed by wind, in particular onshore wind. And if you look at the geography, right, close to half of this new additional capacity will be in Asia Pacific, with more than half of this coming in China. And there are also a few other key markets where it's going to expand, particularly European Union, US, Japan, and India. So in that, there's been a strong growth in over the last decade, and then we're going to see even stronger growth in the next 5 years to come.
Some absolutely staggering numbers there. But reading some of your research, you were saying there's an investment gap. Tell us a little bit about the investment gap that there is existing.
Absolutely. So although the renewable energy investment trends we are seeing globally today are quite encouraging, they're much lower than what is required to achieve net zero by 2050, right? So there is a significant gap between the investment needed to achieve net zero by 2050 and then the capital deployed as of 2022. So a Swiss Re Institute did a study last year, which was published in October 2022. So according to those estimates, as of 2022, this gap, that is the gap between the investment needed to achieve net zero and then the capital deployed in 2022, this gap amounts to around $30 trillion for renewable energy alone. And that's supplying renewable energy alone. And then if you consider the additional infrastructure, such as the grid and then storage, it'll add another $28.4 trillion to the gap. So the question is, how would we close the gap, right? It has to be a combination of multiple solutions. One is, of course, maintaining the current trend of spending, right? We continue to spend the same amount what we are currently doing, but then this will close only around a third of the investment needed. And some part may be redirected from the current fossil fuel investments into the renewables. But then even after these two, there'll still be a significant gap required to achieve net zero. And when you look at the, when you compare by regions, this this shortfall, the net shortfall is even stronger in emerging markets compared to the developing economies. And another important factor I would like to highlight here, Anthony, is that currently there is quite an emphasis on investing in modern renewable energy technologies, namely solar and wind. But there is need of investment in supporting infrastructure, especially right the grid and the storage. And given that the current focus is on infrastructure in renewable energy, the net shortfall is even stronger in the infrastructure. But with the drivers explained earlier and then reduction in the unit cost of renewable electricity production, I think this sector is expected to will attract more investments in the future. And then this sector is set for a rapid growth in the coming years, Anthony.
Thanks very much indeed, Mahesh. So infrastructure investment going to ramp up massively, obviously required insurance, reinsurance for all of that. Let's get now into this, to the meat of this, Michele. Infrastructure investment coming up. Tell us a little bit about the role of the insurance and reinsurance industry in the renewable energy landscape.
Yes, Anthony. You know, it's a pleasure to have this occasion, and the timing is just about right. You see, we are now seeing something that we have not seen in the last 20 years of renewable energy. The cost of green electricity is again, finally is cost competitive with the sources of electricity from traditional fossil fuels, right? This is a game changer. There are tenders now being run in Europe, in particularly, I believe, in Germany, where the tender, the public tender to build the next round of infrastructure is subsidy-free. Right? So that tells you that something has totally changed. Although the technology still has some prototypical elements that send the shiver through the spine of the insurers. Okay? Let's make it clear, right? So let's have a look at the technologies, right? And what insurers can do. So insurers is here to provide risk insight, expertise, and capacity. Right? Swiss Re is proud to provide risk insight, expertise, and also capacity. But our important factor is on the first two. We are then, yes, a major capacity provider, a cornerstone piece of capacity in the global reinsurance market. Now, growth at scale is the news. So now that we have the economics in order for the main technologies, that is solar, photovoltaic, and wind, wind farming onshore, they are the main technologies. And as Mahesh has already mentioned, this is where the growth, the exponential growth is expected to come from. The technologies are mature. Growth at scale means that now the magnitude of investments jumps, right? The lenders and the mainstream investment community is looking to maybe a lower degree of profitability inherent into these technologies and into these sources of electricity, but to a major growth in scale, mm-hmm. knowing that those will probably, at a certain point in the future, question mark when, actually replace a major amount of fossil fuel produced and based electricity, right? So that's the key point. Perils and where insurance comes is we are talking about natural perils. Here, the focus is on natural perils, and that's where traditionally the reinsurers are strong. So in Swiss Re, we have a fantastic team of scientists, experts in NatCat, natural catastrophes. We are working a lot with these guys now, and we are asking them to do the next step in developing models that up to today were not really needed. The models that are needed to understand how the perils, especially in relation to wind, water surge, the strength of the waves, all that relates to the marine environment where the offshore wind farms are coming in. And the offshore wind farms is where the scale matters and where the investment is every time in the order of the billions. Two or three billions are the scale, the capex, capital expenditure, size, magnitude of each one of those wind farms. Mm-hmm. Now, building offshore wind farms is extremely interesting from an intellectual point of view. It's extremely challenging from a technical point of view. It brings the expertise together of a number of lines of business And we'll come back to that, probably. The idea is, how do you provide insurance for an element of, for an occupancy that is developing across various lines of business, right? That's a question mark, and we have done something on that in-house. Now, let me focus on what's happening on the offshore once again, when we are thinking about the where the core experience and expertise of the offshore environment today is, right? Today is with the traditional energy companies. They develop oil rigs, floating, fixed to the bottom, great expertise, great piece of technology, not so much in fashion these days, but that piece of expertise and technology, especially with the offshore contractors, is key. Because the same contractors and the same investors and some of the same shareholders are the ones that today are the major investors in the offshore wind farms. So there is a strange phenomenon, which is called convergence, between the two industries that are using the same technological instruments to achieve the same mean that is producing electricity ultimately, and we have a technology transfer. This technology and experience and transfer of best practices, it's where Swiss Re, together with major reinsurers, have an important role to play. We need to make sure that the quality assurance, quality control, and very, very high safety standards inherent in a volatile and very dangerous industry, such as the hydrocarbons, permeate offshore wind farming. And this is where we are actively engaged with the Center of Competence for Renewable Energy that I have the pleasure to co-lead. Right, let's have a look to the onshore. And I know you're looking at me. Time is short, right? But let's try to touch the onshore wind farms, and because there is an interesting pattern there that's happening. Lack of wind seems like a contradiction in terms, right? You have wind farms, but onshore, the problem that the lenders most of the times raise with the developers is that what's happening if you don't have wind enough? You don't produce enough electricity. Right, so Swiss Re, together with parts of the rest of the market, we are not alone in this, is developing and has placed a number of solutions where the objective is to stabilize the revenue stream, even if the production of electricity, depending on the availability of wind, has actually a variable profile over time. This stabilization effect, the stabilization mechanism via reinsurance product is fundamental because allows bankability of the project, effectively lowers the cost of capital, and allows via provision of reinsurance, not just to pay the loss when they happen, but actually allows to have offshore wind farming becoming an investment grade asset class. So that's a very interesting phenomenon, right? If you want to increase the scale, you need to make it bankable, right? And you need to attract investors. Now, solar is the other main asset class. And as an occupancy, it's particularly delicate in front of strong, unexpected winds. And we don't need so much strong wind on a solar plant to really cause damage. And of course, hailstorms, right? Yeah. Geographic differences matters a lot. And interesting anecdotal one, solar panels are also exposed to earthquake. And we have seen in one occasion already what happened. And so this is something that even if we have a relatively short time of experience with solar panels, we have already seen a catastrophic earthquake destroying a significant amount of solar panels. Fire and flood, other natural perils, are particularly damaging to battery storage. Fire as a thermal runaway process, and flood, of course, that's an electricity component normally in a flood-prone area. The interesting thing on battery storage and where insurance, again, to your question, where insurance comes in, it's actually that we have developed a risk assessment tool, and we have made this available to clients because battery storage is a new occupancy. Again, growing that to scale to support the grid, which is another piece of the story which we are not touching today, but there is the grid that needs to be strengthened significantly. Mm-hmm. Battery storage is a fundamental piece of the future equation, as Christian already mentioned, and we need to be careful there. So we are strengthening this particular aspect in our underwriting teams. Now, I will glide over hydropowers and geothermal. They are very extreme, very tested, well-known technologies since probably more than 150 years, with one caveat. The nice places where to install dams are all taken up already. Mm-hmm. So the new and probably the small ones that are being built today are normally in very, very technically challenging locations. And this is the reason why we see losses on those very, very consolidated known technologies, yeah. Right? It's just the location that is extremely challenging because the best places were already taken, right? Yeah. And finally, on innovation, I would like to just make one comment. Insurability cannot be taken for granted when we have major pieces of equipment that are prototypical or processes are just new, right? So insurability there, it's still a challenge, to be honest.
Okay, and this whole frontier piece that is quite interesting, isn't it? It's there's obviously a huge potential role for insurers there. But I'd like you to get just a little bit more concrete on some of the ways that we're helping clients. Perhaps some specific examples, if you could, on sort of new technology and how we're insuring.
Yeah, you know, scaling up, helping the renewable energy make their path to maturity. Maybe in an accelerated manner, as Christian mentioned, it's a bit important and quite urgent, right? Really, really builds on our industry being the risk experts, giving the right risk insights to the clients. So providing the correct way to factor risks into the whole technological and investment equation, it's paramount, and that's our key role, right? So we mention it. If we get the risk right, and we provide adequate reinsurance for it, ultimately, we end up lowering the cost of capital. Mm-hmm. So there is a direct link where reinsurers are spot on. We need to be there. We need to be heavily involved as enablers of the energy transition. Practical examples. Right. So I mentioned it already, one. The tool for battery storage. Let me just spend a second on that. The tool that we developed, it's part of a wider suite that our own underwriters use to cost, to understand what is the expected cost of the risk, and use that as a driver to price the risk, to put a price to it, an insurance price, right? Now, this is the new one. We rolled it out about a month ago. It complements an existing suite of a number of other tools that our underwriters use. And since a couple of years, I believe, maybe a bit more, we have already made available to clients all these tools. This is just one on top of the others. The interesting bit is, of course, as the industry grows to scale, the data set on which the tools are built needs total revision and revamping. We are doing it one tool after the other. Because the technology is becoming mainstream. Some things that were prototypical 5 years ago, in some cases are mainstream, in other cases are totally obsolete and are being replaced, and we need to update the whole thing. So that's a piece. Now, critical wind models update. We have our in-house team. Our approach is different from the rest of the market, mind. There are some third-party service providers that do modeling very well. Swiss Re does it in-house, right? And this is a strategic decision that has paid out handsomely in the past. And we develop our own tools, again, for our own underwriters, for our teams, across all the lines of business. We are developing the key models for the offshore. Just think to modeling a wind farm in a deep offshore, in typhoon-exposed coast of Taiwan, right? At the moment, to my understanding, the industry is all around building these models, right? We are as well. We have the first one just about ready. We are targeting end of the summer to have the first ones for internal use. We test it, and then we roll out to the client. Same concept, right? So we have this continuous exchange. And then the final point, you see, we are talking about single risks so far. We need to focus also on the treaty, the provision of treaty reinsurance. This is where our role as reinsurers is the more permeating. And on this particular aspect, our treaty underwriters are developing the specific reinsurance products that are needed, fine-tune tailor-made for the severity and frequency profile of renewable energy. That's the first piece. Exchanging with the clients and trying to make sure that their reinsurance buying behavior matches what it's needed for that specifically new set of occupancies. And the next piece is, of course, making sure that what we are studying and developing and advising and proposing for restructuring fits with the overall picture of the overall reinsurance program bought across all the other lines of business by the clients, right? And this means really standing shoulder to shoulder with the insurance companies, with the clients, walking along on the same route, accompanying their shift, the way their portfolio of risks is moving towards the path of renewable, towards renewables more and more towards the energy transition. And we need to enable that and provide more and more capacity at risk to enable this shift. Yeah. Because during the transition, there will be a time when we will have a significant amount of traditional energy, yeah. a significant amount of renewables, yeah. and then at a certain point, the balance will tilt. But that during the transition, we are bound to be more exposed.
Yeah.
And our clients will need our support because their portfolio will be more exposed.
Yeah. Yeah, great. Okay, and then we're getting in here now into the sort of the capabilities for clients. Let's just indulge that for a second. Just tell us a bit more about how you're helping clients right now.
Yeah, so you know we said knowledge, risk insight, and capacity. Right? I need to study it at night and repeat it. You know, what does it really mean? Right? Because words aren't words, but we want to add content to that. Yeah. And. So we have formed the Center of Competence for Renewable Energy. We have collectively had about 3 years of thinking around this before putting it together. Main driver of this formation is the fact that we need to provide an offering to the clients, which is already contemplating the fact that there are multiple lines of business involved. So we need to go over and beyond the division between lines of business. So that's the idea. That's the first concept. The second concept is, in practical terms, our client needs to have a point of entry. And the point of entry into the Swiss Re wider machinery needs to be the same. Mm-hmm. We want the clients to be able to leverage the center of competence for our role in-house in coordinating seamless across the multiple lines of business and bringing the expertise of the various underwriters in their lines to the service together. Now, let me make a comparison, right? So we have a privileged position. The Center of Competence for Renewable Energy has the privilege to stand on the shoulders of the giants, right? The giants are the Swiss Re underwriters. The people that have the in-depth insight into the technology and into the specific market, the geographic region that they are serving, right? So the center of competence needs to do this magic of coordinating the capacities, providing a seamless service to the clients who, via their usual known and long-term relationship point of contact into the Swiss Re world, they need to be able to get a service which is really capable of bringing global knowledge to the specific domestic reality, including the legislation that is applicable in the country. Right. So it's quite a task, right, isn't it? And let me give you an example, quick one. Let's consider again my baby child, which is offshore wind farming, right? Because I think it really helps to understand. It's in the marine environment. You are talking about an area, a geographic area, the wet environment, with complex NatCat conditions. Meteo-ocean conditions in general are harsh. And this is where the experts of the logistics and the experts of the value chain are the marine underwriters. Line of business, marine. Then you have, in a wind farm, you are installing rotating parts called turbines that whose expertise lies with engineering underwriters, line of business engineering, who themselves have seen turbines driven by all sorts of non-renewable sources, or also some of the renewables. I'm thinking to the hydropower dams, right? But the concept is they know how the insurance and the mechanics of a turbine work. And then you have energy upstream underwriters, such as myself, as background. So people that are used to see the enormous size of capital-intensive investments in traditional hydrocarbon, whose focus is subsea, which is relevant for the foundations of the wind farms, and probably in the future, offshore Japan, we will see more and more floating offshore wind farms. So you need to take the expertise of the three underwriters into the same head and offer a comprehensive service for single risk and for treaty, right? For provision of treaty reinsurance. So let me think about that a second and add another comment. And you see, Swiss Re is a reinsurance treaty market leader. We said it, right? And the important thing here to recognize is that we need to provide to our clients the specific form of reinsurance that is needed for this asset class, set of asset classes, for the severity, this frequency, and the way this asset class performs. And some occupancies have not particularly performed well. So we need to be aware of that. And the next piece is, as usual, is to make sure that this is something that it fits into the overall reinsurance buying strategy of the client, which will vary from client to client, right? Mm-hmm. So there is a whole archipelago of considerations to be done. But I pause here.
That's great, Michele. Well, thank you very much indeed to you. John Milley asks, never before in history have countries been able to develop and decarbonize simultaneously. What makes you believe that this time will be different? This time it will be different, or will it be different in the future?
Well, it's difficult to talk about the future, especially when you're a scientist, because you're doing scenarios, right? You do certain assumptions and then you see what your models give you. But maybe on a personal note here, I think countries, and it's really very different from for different countries, countries have to make a decision. Most of the countries, developed countries, but also developing countries, they either still subsidize fossil fuels, or as a country, they spend billions on importing fossil fuels. So if you think about all this money that is kind of like going outside of the country, or even like tax money that is being used to subsidize, if that will be used to actually invest in these no regret decisions like PV, like wind, then you actually can make it into a future where you both have an investment, you have a growth, you have local business, plus at the end you kind of have free energy, right? It's not really free, but you will have energy with very low cost at the end. So I think it's really up to the countries to take this opportunity and make this shift. We all know it's challenging. It's very challenging because you have to, as you said, it's a transition phase. You have to transition from an old world to a new world, and it will hurt. And I think anything that helps these countries make this step will be amazing. And I mean, if you just look at Switzerland, it's kind of easy, right? We already have electricity that is kind of like in a good shape. We still do have 70% of our energy that is being imported mainly as fossils. So we also have to do quite a bit, but okay, we can do it. But if you think about countries that are, let's take Singapore, right? 100% of their energy is fossil-based. Electricity is based on natural gas. All the rest is coming as other fossil fuels. It's challenging. And so I think we as a society in the academia, but also in the industry, if we can help make these transitions, then I think it could be really a win-win at the end.
Yeah, and the added incentive, of course, of the Russia-Ukraine war, I think reminded us about the benefits of energy security as well.
So. Of course. I mean, it was interesting. I mean, again, like looking from Europe, since before the war, nobody talked about securing the supply of natural gas. Yeah. Somehow, even though when I was still working at the Swiss Federal Office of Energy, we wrote reports about security of supply and we looked at gas, but it was not a topic. We talked about the electricity, and then suddenly, of course, it made us aware how dependent we are. Yes.
All right. Thank you. Next question. Mahesh, perhaps this one for you, if you're ready and microphone set. Are projects currently able to secure the financing they need?
Anthony, overall, I would say availability of low-cost finance for renewable energy is a challenge. But things are changing, things are improving. Earlier, if you see the way it was financed, it was largely either the government-funded or the funds by the government institutions or multinational organizations. But now, with the change in technology and the cost of installations coming down, and with many government supports in terms of tax cuts or subsidies, and more importantly, many projects being bankable, right? Many solar, since the solar and renewable wind technologies are mature enough, they're established. And then so they can see the guaranteed returns, and then see they become bankable. Private funding is also flowing in, right? So overall challenging, things are changing. So if you look at, I think, last couple of years, the overall funding of private sector has been higher than the public sector funding. But then it is not same across the globe, right? It depends on the type of projects, locations, returns they can offer, and then the policies in the specific market. It all depends on these factors, whether the financing is available or not.
Okay, all right. Thank you, Mahesh. Next one, Michele, for you. What technologies are ready to go full scale from a reinsurance perspective?
Yes, Anthony, I think we mentioned it. Solar, photovoltaic, and wind on shore are definitely ready to go, are up and running. Mm-hmm. They are the ones on which the world is betting in terms of scale up. Mm-hmm. I think we can all see that in the numbers that Mahesh was commenting. It's something that Christian mentioned. There are a number of other technologies that have the potential to be really disruptive. In theory, we still need to demonstrate technologically that can be scaled up, right? Mm-hmm. At the moment, solar photovoltaic at residential scale, at utility scale, even more so, because that's where cost effectiveness kicks in, and onshore, and then potentially offshore wind farming. Offshore wind farming will grow massively in terms of percentages, but still the installed capacity already available onshore is much bigger and will continue to be much bigger.
Okay, but presumably huge headwinds, obviously, from what we call in the UK, we call NIMBYs, which is not in my backyard. It's the sort of the planning opposition, whereas offshore obviously doesn't face
that,
I suppose.
Absolutely. Yeah. That's what happened what happens always when you build offshore infrastructure beyond the horizon.
Yeah.
It's not seen, right? Mm. But of course, the offshore environment needs to factor in, have a proper analysis done, mm-hmm. to make sure that location chosen to install any installation, critically wind farms, as we are speaking about those, do not interfere with marine life.
Yeah.
And this is something that the developers are really paying attention of, right? Yeah. And you wanted to add something, sure, Christian. Yeah.
Well, no, I fully agree with this. we said it before, these are the short-term, mid-term technologies, and I think it's really the no-regret things, right? Especially onshore, offshore, with all the additional risk. And then if you want to look more mid-term, long-term, whatever that means, but let's say 2040 and beyond, of course, the one discussion is small nuclear reactors. That's still a very open question. Will we have it? Will we not having? I mean, right now we don't even have a prototype, so we are ahead, but potentially that could be something that we need to look at. And then, so more like a niche at the moment, but I think it will be interesting. I mentioned the whole negative emission technologies. It's really something that not a lot of people are talking about, but when you look at any of these scenarios, we will not reach net zero. If we get rid of all the fossil fuels, we still have emissions. So we need to get to net zero by having negative emissions. And there are technologies, there's ETH spinoff that we all know, right? And there's also new companies coming in, like Norikstark, who do cement, using cement, recycled cement to do negative emissions. Yeah. But the whole infrastructure behind it, we don't know yet. I mean, we are actually looking at the need for CO2 grids, which is, of course, and again, a huge emission. So this is, there are a lot of these things that are kind of like not being discussed, but they will need to come, and pretty quick. Right. I mean, it's not in 100 years. It's in 10, 20 years, right? Absolutely. And of course, we talked about the whole storage, batteries, etc. Yes.
Okay, thank
you. Just to give a few examples.
No, that's great. Thank you. Michele, how can you effectively manage price risk considering the significant variations in energy price forecasts that can substantially impact project profitability?
That's a challenging one, isn't it? Right. Well, you see, let's make it clear. There are a number of risks that insurance can cover. Other risks are not for insurance to cover. Let's just say it bluntly, right? I don't want to dwell specifically into price risk, but everything that relates to market fluctuations, commercial dynamics, where there is not such a thing as a sudden and accidental and fortuitous physical loss or physical damage, should not be picked up by insurance. Let's just say it clearly. We are an industry that takes care of the downside potential of the investment. Yeah. We never benefit of the upside potential of the original investment in infrastructure. Mm-hmm. So we pay losses, but we don't participate in the revenues. And price risk, most of the times, is part of the upside potential, right? What we can cover is the lack of fundamental wind, availability of wind, availability of solar radiation, and availability of water. We do have non-traditional forms of reinsurance. Mm-hmm. We call them solutions. We define them as sometimes they fall into the realm of parametric covers, things that are more common in agriculture insurance, for example. But let's be clear. One thing is insurance and reinsurance, which is based on a technical analysis of hard data and modeling of those data. And other things are risks that are more related and connected to the financial performance of the project. And we are not a market for that.
Okay, very clear. Question here from Robert McMillan. How do you consider the quality and resilience of renewable products getting better at the OEMs when there is a significant need to expand supply there? So I think sort of the ramping up that we were talking about, have been talking about through this discussion, obviously, you know, I think the implication, the question is that the quality and the resilience of the products could fall as a result of that. Do we see that as a risk? Is that something you're looking at, Michele?
So this is a very specific and very extensive discussion.
Okay.
And I would suspect that one of the reasons why this question is triggered is because there have been significant problems with prototypical elements, mm-hmm. Prototypical processes, and defects that have emerged either in the pieces, in the components, or in the way the components have been assembled, right? We will not exhaust this discussion in a couple of minutes. This is priority high on the radars of the insurers and also of the developers, because the developers, the OEM, the equipment manufacturers, the manufacturers of the components, and everybody that provides a guarantee as to the performance of those components, mm-hmm. are acutely aware that a severe and structural malfunctioning, mm-hmm. will severely impact not just that specific project, will have cascading effect across the entire portfolio of projects in which that equipment is deployed and embedded. And that has major implications for the value of that piece of equipment and potentially of the manufacturer itself.
Okay.
So it is a problem that needs to be tackled throughout the industry.
All right. Well, that's clearly something we could spend a lot longer on. I'm going to have to stop it there. We're about to hit the deadline. Thank you very much indeed for joining us for our session today. If you would like to know more about the cyber center of competence, I beg your pardon, the renewable center of competence here at Swiss Re, you can do so by contacting contacting Michele. We'll send you a recording of this session immediately after the show, alongside some other materials that you might find of interest. Thank you very much indeed for joining us today.
Thank you, Anthony.
Thank you.